Kamak, who plays with Ahmad Jamal, and people like Charnette Moffat, who plays kind of with everybody, and including who was he playing with? Well, anyway, these are cats that when I hear them, they're cats who are better, but that's just like outside of my understanding. But when I hear them, I'm like, okay, that's what I would say if I could speak musically, that is.
That's interesting that you were inspired by the sound of the boats off the coast of New York and everything, and not necessarily an actual musician. Because I'm actually, as you were saying that, I was thinking two things. One is that I had not done that much traveling, and I still need to do a lot more. But I went for my first cruise, not this past Christmas, but the Christmas before. So, like, Christmas of, this is 2019, Christmas 2017. And while I was on that cruise, of course, hearing those boats bellowing and everything, and that was my first time going to the Virgin Islands and Puerto Rico and all of that kind of environment. Of course, you hear the music in the out in the squares and in, just out in the streets and everything. So that was definitely a different kind of thing. But then as you were saying it, I was thinking to myself, Jeremy's got this train that goes by all the time that blows its whistle.
Yes.
And I know that the train was part of our history. I'm wondering if maybe some youth isn't hearing that train whistle and thinking to themselves, hey, I need to learn how to play an instrument that's similar to this train, because that train is definitely a part of the fabric of Durham.
Yes. You know, I'll tell you, first of all, I was already very moved by the various train sounds in New York. We're talking the rumbling underground and then the clacking overhead, stuff like that. So that used to always turn up in my writing. I'd, in terms of my playing, I did compose a couple of pieces where I borrow some of those sounds. There's one part where there's the bell when the doors are closing and so forth in one of my pieces. And then I there's some other part that I imitate the sax players that are always down in the tunnels blowing away, you know. But as we're coming down to Durham, there was that actual whistle. And I loved it.
Right.
I thought, you know, I could live near that. And every person that I dated, every woman, said, ain't no way. So I had to let that go. But I really wanted to get a place by the tracks for that reason. And it's one of the reasons why I like people like Tom Waits, a real weird musician, because the train is constantly turning up in his pieces as a theme, a constant theme. You know, and in his songs he's talking about getting away, traveling, seeing things, et cetera, you know. But, yeah, quite a bit of it.
Yeah, he definitely does that on a regular basis, and there's others that do that also. And, of course, you know, this is a blues town, and the blues was definitely a lot of those players were either working in the tobacco factories or they were part of house parties that were tied into the tobacco factories and some of the other factories that were tied into Durham. Because, I mean, I know that John D. Holman, who's a blues artist here, definitely did some work in the factories when he first moved here. I want to say that Brownie McGhee and others did also. But they were definitely involved in that whole culture because there was a whole blues culture that came out of there. And I'm sure that there were jazz artists that were involved in that as well.
That's right. That's right. I'm not as well-versed on the blues here locally, much more on the jazz side. But I definitely have an appreciation and respect for that history.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah, and
now, who are some of the historical jazz people that you enjoyed? Had you heard of Brother Youssef when you moved here, or did people tell you about Brother Youssef? Did they tell you about Paul Jeffries? Did you have any dealings? And I'm going to mention the name of somebody that was definitely tied into that kind of culture later in life who unfortunately passed away recently. Did you have any ties with Reggie Jeffries and people of that nature? So were there some of these people that you first met when you first came to town from New York?
Not so much. I started more on the student side. And, you know, yes, I have a lot of professionals, you know, are my clients. However, my focus when I came was to tie myself to the schools. So right now I fix string instruments, not just bass, though that's my specialty, for like most of Durham schools, almost all of Chapel Hill schools, and part of Wake County, and a couple out in Burlington. And so that's how it began first. It's that and a whole bunch of students and then their families telling other families and so forth. And so the professional musicians, I just kind of had to meet later on over time. And some of the top, you know, some of the cats like you mentioned, it's we haven't actually crossed paths, but we know the same people. So it's like it's only a matter of time. Then there are others who are just starting to hit that kind of infamy, you know, if you want to call it that. People like Al Strong and others who are becoming national, who are very, very local that I do know well. But yeah, still business in progress. This has only been 5 years for me.
Gotcha. And what is, other than the fact that people think that you're a Lutheran, what are some of the other misconceptions that people have about your field of work, as well as just about the care of those instruments? Because I'm imagining there's certain things that people probably do that you're just shocked that they're doing in terms of, like, the way that they care for their instruments. So what are some of the things that you always have to warn people about in terms of the care of their instruments, and even some things that you are oftentimes surprised that you have to tell people? So maybe even some common sense things that you're just surprised that you have to let people know about that.
That is a really good question. There are like a host of small things. A great example that shocks me all the time: clean your darn instrument. You know, if you keep a dry cloth for any string instrument, but I have to especially tell the bassist this, if you keep a dry cloth after you finish playing, wipe the thing down. So your finger, you know, we have like natural finger oils that occur in our fingers and so forth. So even if you think, no, my hands are clean, I'm not eating food, you're still getting stuff on your strings, your fingerboard. And when you use a bow, we use a sticky substance called rosin. That kind of flakes off and powders down. If you hit it right away, it's like nothing. It's like blowing dust off. But if you let it sit, it hardens up like rock. And then people come to me, hey, can you get rid of this, man? No, I can't. Just wipe your darn instrument. So those simple things, cleaning your instrument, things like, what do you call, making sure that you keep a consistent temperature and humidity at your house, you know, for where you're storing your instrument. Some cats, you know, they'll go from hot to cold, wherever, and travel with the bass and not think twice about it, and then are surprised when things swell or shrunk and cracked, you know. But the next thing, and the biggest, would be this. It's natural. It's normal for the bass or your instrument to open up at the edges, the seams we call them, as the humidity changes and so forth. Even with all that care, like I was talking about, these things will still open up a little bit over time. You've got to turn the tuners to take some of the tension off the instrument. People will have like the entire back open or the entire side open, and the instrument is still fully tuned up. Well, that's pulling it out of shape. It's now warping and so forth, and it takes a lot of work to try to get that back. So just that as a measure, you know, is, you know, things start to open up to take the tension off the strings and so forth. And there are a bunch of other things, but I don't want to bore the listeners with all of that.
No, I'm sure. Don't continue to share. We definitely enjoyed it, and I'm sure the listeners are as well. But I'm imagining there are probably things that you're even shocked that recording studios and some of like our venues don't necessarily do in terms of the care for instruments as well, because I know a lot of times recording studios might even have instruments there, but, you know, if the instrument's been sitting there forever, it probably needs some tuning as well. So I'm sure, that, I mean, not so much, the piano is the instrument that is always at a venue, but I do know that there are venues and places that have drum kits, and there are probably some that even have basses and other string instruments. So I was just wondering, what has your experience been with venues and how they treat the instruments?
I found kind of the same thing. The venues will have instruments, and they really don't give any thought to care. They just kind of sit them in a corner until they're needed, and do weird things to adjust for changes on the instrument. So I've seen, like, I do house calls. It's part of the name Dr. Bass, where it came from. I still do house calls. And I've been called to studios before where they're like, man, I keep on lowering this bridge and so forth, but the strings are still too high and so forth, and it wasn't like this the last time we played. And you just follow up to the top of the bass, and you find out the neck was half out. So if something's changing drastically, you don't keep on twisting and torquing somewhere else to compensate for it. You got to stop. Something's wrong, you know. So that I've encountered with at least two studios and one club, that same problem I just described, where the neck kick had come out of the slot. But they weren't paying attention to that, the structural change. They were looking down at where the strings were over the board, and it's like, oh, it's too low, or it's too high. What can I do? Let me stick something under here. It's just not normal, you know.
And I imagine that sometimes people also, which probably drives you crazy, but, you know, whether it's the dust of just the common house or where people may be keeping their stuff in their studios and everything, but people also have animals, like whether it's a dog, cat, whatever. And I'm imagining that sometimes when you come to these places on your house visit, you're amazed at how close they're letting the critters get to the instruments as well. Is that an incorrect perception on my part?
No, that's very correct. You know, they'll put them in basements and attics or whatever else, and often bring them to me, and I discover whatever critters. I've come across some horrible things. I've, you know, like a snake skin, like a shedding or whatever inside one of these things, and freaked me out. You know, it's like you got to know where all that life is and not leave your open instrument there, you know. But you're right. I have encountered that quite a bit.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So what have been some of the most unusual experiences you've had as Dr. Bates? You just mentioned the snake that you found in the instrument. You mentioned people, like I said, the Lutheran versus luthier conversation. But what have been some of the other crazy conversations or just crazy things that have happened to Dr. Bates? I'm imagining that Dr. Bates has had one or two stories that he would love to share that would just trip people out.
Okay. There are a number of them. The first was, well, not in any particular order, but let me think. It's crazy and weird. I guess one of them would be a base that came to me that from all of the one side, it looked like a normal bass, and then you look at the front, it's flat with a sound hole in the middle like a guitar. It turned out that it had damage in the front and the back, and somebody just bought Douglas fir, you know, plywood from the hardware store and cut it in the shape of a bass and stuck it in the front and the back. And the guy wanted to know, can you work on this? Can you tune it up? No. It was outside the structure of what a bass is supposed to be. So there's that. Then there was a there was one cello that came to me that had a sword thrown through it. And this came from a high school. And the story apparently is that somebody in the theater department was playing with one of the props, and it came loose from the sheath or whatever and flew across the room. The music department's across the hall and went through a cello. And it begs the question, you have a sword that real that it could travel like that and go through a cello? That means a kid could have gotten killed. You know, they were really lucky. So things like
Go ahead. I'm just imagining like this sword flying through the school grounds, and you're right. That just sounds totally dangerous if it's flying through from one classroom to another.
Yes, indeed. That's right. Right across the hall and through one side, through the rib, we call it, across the bass bar, like chopped through it and out the other rib. So that's like impaling a human being. But I think one of the worst experiences, one of the funniest and weirdest, was a guy who came down from another state, drove with the bass, no gig bag, no cover on it, strapped to the top of his car. He has stickers all over the thing. He had an ashtray that he built into the front of the instrument, because apparently he smokes while he plays. You can only imagine the condition of the wood and everything when he brought this to me for fine tuning.
Were you able to rescue this instrument? I'm thinking this instrument was beyond saving.
I was able to do some things. You know, there's a sound post, there's a stick that goes from front to back and a bass bar on the other side. I was able to adjust those things to get him some, you know, decent sound. He wasn't looking for anything deep, rich, growly, you know, like a classical or jazz player. It was more he needed thump. And so that I was able to accomplish despite the condition. But that was quite an adventure.
I'm sure. Now, I'm imagining, speaking of adventures, you know, the bass, and particularly the kind of bass that you're talking about, and definitely I would argue most of the string instruments, we usually think of them as being instruments of more like classical style music. So I'm thinking jazz, I'm thinking classical music, I'm thinking things of that nature. But I do know for a fact, because as I just mentioned to Dean, one of the groups I saw at Sister Montos, I think is the name of the group, but they were at the Eno, and they were definitely more of a rockish kind of group out of the California area. The musician that's the leader of the group is a digital media teacher. But, you know, his player was definitely thumping the instrument and definitely, you know, stroking it with some force and fever, for lack of a better term. So I'm thinking
that
can be one of your more difficult times when you're having basses and other string instruments that have been played by some of the more less than traditional instruments for those, less than traditional styles of music for those instruments. So I'm thinking like rock, I'm thinking like heavy metal, I'm thinking like, you know, certain sounds like that. So I was wondering if you've had those kind of incidents where you've had people that have, you know, put the music in an art form that not necessarily what we think of it being traditional.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I do have plenty of those kinds of clients, and I do work on a lot of non-traditional instruments as well. I know that goes a little bit off the question,